But in the postmodernist world, which is the world inevitably that you involve when you start talking to individuals, consumers, citizens, here's the kind of world you get. This is the work of David Mark and Andrew Turk. David's at Buffalo, Andrew's at Australia. And they've been working with an Aboriginal tribe in Western Australia and asking them essentially, what would you want to map and what would you call it? And the answer to both of those questions is not what we would expect, because as an Aboriginal tribe, what they think is important is very different. So here, in the upper two of the illustrations, are what they call Wundu, which is a dry river bed. I had to use three words to describe that in English. In Spanish, I might use arroyo. Not something that we typically consider significant on the landscape. Or the lower level, more so, this is what they were calling Barga, which is a shallow valley leading up into a hill. It's typically not a stream bed. It has some vegetation. It tends to attract animals, which is why it's important for their society. These are the kinds of things they would map. Very different from what we would want to map, very different from what the Australian government, Commonwealth government in Canberra traditionally has chosen to map. So what we're dealing with here is the notion that the stuff you map is a social construction. The question of what it's called, if you're English and you grew up with English maps, it's called the English Channel. If you're French and you grew up with French maps, it's called La Manche. We always dealt with that. It was a matter of what language you were speaking. But we would also want to know who calls it that, whose national agency and mapping agency made the map, what community made the map, what type of feature is it, in whose system of types, and where is it, where's the boundary. All of these become much more complex questions once you reduce mapping to a community level. And we've seen how important this can be. Many, many examples of international conflicts are where things no more significant. On the other hand, Google, Microsoft, and Yahoo, in the summer of 2011, developed something they call schema model work, which is a common vocabulary for describing the Earth. It's a global standard agreed to by three companies. And here's what it says about what you can map. Everything on the Earth's surface is a thing. If it's got a geographic location, it's a place. And here are the classes of sports activity and location, which is a kind of place. Resort sports club. Try to relate that to a tribe in Western Australia. One of the categories of retail store is Asian grocery store. Makes excellent sense in San Jose, California. Makes no sense whatever in Beijing. So here you've got two extremes, right? On the one hand, technology is allowing us to go global with the way we view the world or the macro. The other extreme, crowdsourcing down at the community level, is allowing us to represent the individual variations of communities and languages across the Earth. Which direction should we be heading in? In my view, the answer is quite clear. It's the down to the local, not up to the global. I can't see any future in a globally standardized mapping program, because it will inevitably force viewpoints different parts of the world. So I want to take you into an area that I think is developing very rapidly as a research topic and really should be part of what we talk about. And here's just an illustration to start with. It's not very clear, but the mayor recognized Paris. And this is an analysis of all of the Flickr photographs that are tagged Eiffel Tower. And it uses a variety of languages, so Eiffel Tower in Italian or whatever. And the Eiffel Tower itself is that big blob in the lower left. And there are some other blobs because people have taken photographs of the Eiffel Tower from the top of the Montparnasse and from other places in Paris. So what we're dealing with here is a place, Eiffel Tower, and its expression in terms of space. And that illustrates a dichotomy which has always existed in the discipline of geography. And that's between space and place. Space is about coordinates and distances and directions. Place is about names. Places exist in the human mind think about and talk about, they don't necessarily exist on the map as polygons. In GIS, we've struggled with that, and essentially we've come down on the side of space. We've said, if you can't put a polygon around it, we're not going to worry about it. There's a book from about a decade ago on geographic objects with indeterminate boundaries. Various ways of dealing with that, putting a boundary around something. So I want to suggest, as part of a vision for the future, that we need to be thinking about what we call place-based GIS instead of a space-based GIS. This is a GIS where the linkages are made by name and not by coordinates. There are linkages between Eiffel Tower, as expressed in all sorts of sources. This is a world that doesn't insist that maps be planimetrically controlled, but thinks of sketch maps as useful and having useful functions. It's a world in which many GIS functions are impossible because you can't really overlay and compute an intersection, but many new ones are possible. It gives you a whole new perspective on positional accuracy. Why do this? Because this is the way humans think. Humans think, reason with, and describe places. They don't describe coordinates. And very, very few people, and there are a few exceptions to this room, I'm sure, very, very few people know the coordinates, the latitude, longitude, and anything. Placial technology, as distinct from spatial technology, and perhaps parallel to it. Here's a crude example. This is a glacial technology. This is Henry Beck's original map of the London Underground. It's glacial. It's absolutely not planimetric. The center of London has been distorted outwards. The spacing between the stations has been regularized. The rail lines have been reduced to simple straight lines. Every city in the world has adopted something like this to represent its transit system. Why? Because humans can use it. Humans can use it to get around. If you compare it to a planimetric map of the London Underground, you can see it all. The London Underground is so complex in the 16th century, you've got to blow it up at an inset, and it's a mess. And everyone, I think, would rather have the Beck map than the planimetric map. So here's a research agenda. Here's a set of challenges for the research. How do you create schematics? Can you write a computer program to take a planimetric map and convert it into an easy-to-use schematic? How can you personalize this stuff? If you think about a schematic as something displayed on your iPhone, how can you personalize it so that it's user-centered, dynamic, reflects the criteria used by individuals? How can you conflate planimetric and schematic information? And what's the functionality of the equation? So, bottom line, think place. We've always thought space. But place, I think, has some really important possibilities. So, let's try to pull this together and summarize what I've been talking about. Where are we now? The digital globes implement parts of the core vision, but not all. They fall short in providing data access. A digital Earth should be an easy means of accessing and downloading data. And they fall short in terms of being able to simulate the future. Something I think that would be very, very important, very well received. Many people have been thinking about the next generation of digital Earth, and I'll just very quickly scan through a few of them. The Vespucci Institute, which meets every year in Florence, had a meeting in 2008 to develop a vision for the next generation, to update the Gore speech graph. And it's published as the reference, it's easy to find on the web. There's an 8-point vision of what a next generation digital Earth might look like. Not one digital Earth, but a variety of digital Earths available to individual citizens and communities, problem-oriented so that it could focus specifically on issues of social concern, allowing us to search through time and space and a variety of others. No one would be interested in time or whatever the details of them. And the International Society for Digital Earth held a very similar meeting in Beijing in March you ever look for one source of a vision for the next generation of digital Earth, I hope this will be it. This is a paper published in the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences this summer, just a couple of months ago. And it goes over essentially what I've been talking about in the last little while. I think there's a very important point to be made underlying all of this. I want to argue that information about the planet should be considered to be a basic human right. All of us should have the right of access to information about the planet and its future. Why? We're all invested in the future of the planet. It's the only one we'll ever have. National governments have less and less control over the flow of information. Information these days comes from the community, goes back to the community with very little filtering by national governments. Digital Earth facilitates access to Earth information as never before. It's an accessible platform that anyone can use to access information about the planet. Digital Earth can offer effective communication between science and the citizen. It's an effective way of communicating the results of science about the planet's state, about its future state, citizen, and I believe that it should have greater emphasis on prediction and on how the planet works. So where are we heading with all of this? One of the things that I'm sure everyone is conscious of is that this field has grown exponentially over the past few decades. When Roger Tomlinson organized his first meetings on spatial data handling, he was lucky to get 50 people from around the world. These days, this is a vast field. Huge numbers of people invested in GIS in one form or another. So where are we going? We're advancing at an accelerating rate. New technologies are appearing faster and faster. Apple's new maps in its ideal version. It's a tremendously impressive platform. So Gore talks about a virtual reality. It's an escapist kind of speech in which someone goes into another world to explore the Earth. That, I think, has its place, and of course, many of us do this all the time. We use GIS technology to explore the world. But increasingly, we're seeing GIS technology being used to augment reality. When you are in the field, in place, and you use an iPhone to access information about where you're standing, information that's not immediately available to you, information about what's around the corner, information about what's under the street. All of these are augmentations of what you yourself can touch and see and hear and feel. But I think we've got to think one step further, because I think the future is taking us into a world which is neither virtual reality nor augmented reality. It's a world in which physical and virtual realities are fully integrated, where digital technology is so integrated in our lives that it's largely invisible and largely incomprehensible. I have already reached the point where I don't understand everything that's going on in some of these applications. And I'm sure that sense will grow and grow and grow. There's a new sense of incomplete awareness of what's going on in the technology, incomplete control over the technology. That's, I think, the world in which we're in. It's a world in which GIS technology is so pervasive that it's in every aspect of our lives and is largely invisible. And that vision, I think, is at once exciting and powerful and also very frightening. But that, I think, is the future we face, and thank you very much for your attention.